Welcome back, everybody. For decades, Muslims have been told by their authorities that the Quran has been perfectly preserved without a single textual variant in its manuscripts. The number of Muslims, however, who believe this lie is declining since evidence to the contrary has arisen. Much evidence has come to light on this issue in recent decades, and much of it is easily available to the public. As such, many Muslims simply abandon this theory of miraculous preservation of the text of the Quran and resort to the second option, that the Quran has been perfectly preserved through memorization and oral recitation. However, this theory has some problems. Number one is the trust issue. Muslims have told us over and over and over and over and over and over and over again that the Quran has been miraculously preserved, not a single variant in its manuscripts. This has been found to be a lie. So why should we trust you now when you're telling us that the Quran has been miraculously preserved through oral tradition? In addition to the trust issue, this theory is also ad hoc. When one theory about miraculous preservation has been shown to be false, another one simply rises to the surface. That seems a bit too coincidental. Thirdly, Muslims cannot bear the burden of proof. They can claim all they want that millions and millions of millions of people over the centuries have memorized and so perfectly preserved the Quran. They can claim this all they want, they can believe it all they want, but they can't prove it. Number four, it fails to explain variants in the manuscripts themselves. Now, this can be unpacked in a couple of different ways. One of them is to look at the variants themselves and say, these don't look like variants that have arisen through a strong oral tradition of the Quran. So that's the first way, and that's what we're going to look at in this video. But there's also a second way to look at this. If there was a strong oral transmission of the Quran present, then the early Muslims did not know about it. And there are a couple of different reasons why that's true, but we can actually look back at times when Ibn Abbas and Ali proposed changes to the text of the Quran, corrections to it. They did not reference an oral preservation or an oral tradition of the Quran to do this. They were looking at manuscripts. So if there was some sort of a miraculous oral preservation of the Quran, the early Muslims did not know about it, and indeed it would have had to have separated very early from the written textual transmission of the Quran. More on some of that as we go through this video. Fifthly, Muslims have to explain why belief in perfect oral preservation is simply a modern development. Why does this look so much like a doctrine among Muslims that has simply evolved with time? The early Muslims certainly didn't know about it. We find Ali proposing emendations of the Quran, as well as Ibn Abbas. And here is some more very problematic evidence. Let none of you say, I've got the whole Quran. Much of it is gone. Simply say, I have got what has survived. Additionally, we have evidence from Sahih Muslim for certain surahs being forgotten. Now, there's much more we could say along these lines, but you can see why these 5 points present such a difficulty. But there is another difficulty for Muslims, and this one is possibly the most significant for many. Lurking behind the sentiment that scholars proposing emendations of the Quranic manuscripts is an act of enormous hubris is a sensitivity to popular Islamic reverence for the Quran, and attendant claims that it is God's eternal speech that its continuous oral transmission has prevented its textual corruption or modification. Such attitudes, while they accurately reflect what Muslim youth are taught at home or at the local mosque, do not hold up when examined in the light either of Western critical scholarship or of traditional Islamic scholarship on the Quran. Now let's get the opinions of some scholars who actually spend their time in Quranic manuscripts to see what they say about the nature of textual variants in the Quran. Daniel Brubaker says the scribes looked at an existing copy in order to make a new copy, rather than either writing from memory or writing from hearing a recitation. Now, why is this the case? Well, when you look at the types of mistakes that are in the manuscripts of the Quran, what we see is the omission of words and phrases, for example, or perhaps repeating words or phrases. These are the types of mistakes that arise when a scribe is momentarily distracted. He looks away from the manuscript for some reason, say to dip the nib of his pen in ink. When he returns to the manuscript, he begins at the wrong place. These types of mistakes are evidence of a strong written tradition, not oral. James Bellamy discusses some textual variants in his 1993 article, saying, "The variant readings are important to us here because they prove that there was no oral tradition stemming directly from the prophet strong enough to overcome all the uncertainties inherent in the writing system." Devin Stewart's essay was published in a collection called The Quran in Its Historical Context. He says, "In addition, while many of the variants recognized as legitimate within Islamic tradition may plausibly have arisen through oral transmission, many others cannot, being based on graphic and not phonic resemblance." Now, examples of these variants get really dry very quickly, so we'll just look at one. Ibn Abbas, cousin of the Prophet and a famous early commentator, is credited with detecting and correcting several errors in the text. In 1331, we find Afalam yai asiladina amanu, have not those who believed despaired. Ibn Abbas, following Ibn Mas'ud, read yatabayan, have they not seen clearly. The words yayas and yatabayan are so different that such a mistake could not have occurred in the oral tradition, so we have to look to the written tradition for an explanation. Now, the issue with this example is not the interpretation of the variant reading, rather the significance of it is that it shows a predominantly written transmission over an oral transmission. Now, these variants certainly do seem mundane to the untrained eye, but for those who spend their time in these manuscripts, the evidence is conclusive and compelling. The common argument that an uninterrupted and completely reliable oral transmission has miraculously preserved the text of the Quran from such errors falls flat. Modern Muslims can no longer claim that the Quran has been miraculously preserved, either in written or oral form. Those were only claims that Islamic authorities could spread among Muslims when the evidence wasn't available for external examination. These are only lies that Islamic authorities could spread among Muslims in areas where Islam is isolated from criticism. It's easy to see why claims like this can thrive in the vacuum of Islamic thought. So, what is more troubling, Muslims? The fact that Allah lied when he said, "We will guard it from corruption," or that your modern authorities have been lying to you about the perfect preservation of the Quran, either in written or oral form? With the claims about miraculous oral or written preservation of the Quran now falling flat, what's your next move, Muslims? Are you going to think of a third excuse, or are you going to take a more critical look at your religion? Thanks for watching.